God dwell together in unity. So as we've come together as a corporate body, would you please stand and let's lift up our voices as we sing these truths.
Traveling, for those who are recovering, and we are glad that you're here. If this is your first time to join us at Wieuca, you're an honored guest. If you've joined us via Facebook Live, we're extremely glad that you're a part of our worship experience. If you're watching online, make sure to drop us a note or a text and let us know that you're watching. We'd love to thank you for being a part of our worship experience. Now, in addition to many other guests who've gathered with us here, it is really good to have our pastor emeritus and his wife, Mark and Kim Wilbanks. Mark and Kim, welcome home to Wieuca. We're glad you're here. been looking forward to having one of our dear friends and former students come sing for us. As it turns out, on the weekend, Mark and Kim are here. Pat Barker, who is one of the most well-known voices and personalities in gospel music, is also the minister of music, along with his lovely wife, Linnell, or First Baptist Williams, my former church, where Mark and Kim have been adopted as family. And so it worked out beautifully for Pat to be here. I could say a lot about Pat, but I've asked Mark, when he reads the scripture later on, to bring greetings to the congregation and to introduce Pat. Pat's going to sing a couple of selections in today's service. And hang around afterward and say hello to Pat as well. I'm really glad that you're here. This is a special weekend. It's MLK weekend, and we're focused on the themes of equality and love and justice. But also, it's the birthday weekend of our own beloved Dorothy Pryor. When I first came here, I found out Dorothy had roots back in Alabama, part of Judson University. She was acquainted with all my old stomping grounds. And this weekend, we joyfully celebrate with Dorothy on her 98th birthday. And Dorothy, your congregation would love the privilege of singing happy birthday to you. Join with Rixie, lead us in singing. After Ashley will lead us in our call to worship.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Dorothy. Happy birthday to you.
Good morning. Jamila is away celebrating her birthday with her mother this weekend in Louisiana, so she is having a wonderful time, but definitely misses being here with all of us as well. So if you join with me, Triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you have adopted us as your children, and you have lavished your grace upon our lives as individuals and as a people. May all we do here equip us for ministry, build us up as the body of Christ. Strengthen our unity in the faith, deepen our knowledge of Jesus, our Lord, and help us to grow into maturity as your children.
Would you please stand?
Praise is honored.
It is so good to be here. I appreciate you arranging the weather for us. We don't have weather like this in Birmingham. Kim and I are delighted to be here. You know, I know most of you, and you're such a part of our lives, and we're just so thankful for you. I am sorry that we haven't been here more often, but I'd like to explain who's to blame. Your pastor gave my name to this church in Jacksonville, Alabama. 18 months of interim there, and loved it. Great people over there, and they love Barry and Amanda, and just, we're so thankful for their leadership here. Barry's a good friend, and I appreciate the gifts he brings to the ministry here at Wieuca. We pray for you all the time. We really do. Know that these are important days, and God has some great things in store, and I hope you cling to that and that you hold to that promise. I want to tell you about the man he's about to sing for us. Got to know him really well. He and his family, they're delightful people. You know, they, every now and then they have these contests to vote for who's the best singer, you know, in a bass or tenor or whatever. And I know he gets two votes because I vote for him and I know he votes for him. Of all the bass singers in the entire world, he's one of them. I'd rather hear him sing than eat, because I've heard him eat. But I'm bummed. No, seriously, you're about to be blessed. I listen to him on Spotify or on a CD that he has. He's a part of a group called The Guardians, and they travel really all over and a part of some amazing worship services, concerts, and so forth. He is a dear friend. I love him to death. You're going to be blessed when he comes to sing in just a moment. I would give your attention to the reading of God's Word. The 15th chapter of John is one of my favorites because it is a part of the farewell discourse. Jesus, as he is making his way to the cross, and his disciples are trying to make sense of what is happening to him. And so these are sort of his last words and testament, if you will, as he's trying to pass on so much of what he wants them to understand. So I'm reading from John chapter 15. These are verses 9 through 12. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now, remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning. See if you remember this great old hymn, by the way. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul for which long I have sought since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul, like the sea billows roll, since Jesus came into my heart. I shall go there to dwell in that city I know, since Jesus came into my heart. And I'm happy, so happy, as onward I go, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul, like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul. soul like the sea billows roll. Since Jesus came into my heart.
Amen.
We are so thrilled to have Pat this morning. It's like we're in the presence of Johnny Cash. Oh my goodness. So grateful for your ministry, brother. Would you please stand as we continue to worship and sing this hymn, Holy, 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 as we focus in on the character.
Thank you.
called together to love and serve you and the world that you so love. Thank you for the many ways you have blessed this community as one part of your worldwide body. Strengthened for service by gratitude, we dedicate ourselves to you. Help us to walk in step with your Spirit, our Comforter, God, and God. Amen.
Well, it is a pleasure to be here. I'll just very quickly just tell you a little bit about myself. I still go to the First Baptist Church of Williams. My dad was the music minister there. We went there when I was 12 years old, and the ferry came on. And when I started singing full time, I moved to Pensacola, and before I even got a house, I joined at First Baptist Pensacola, and once again, Barry was my pastor, and it was an honor and a privilege to be able to be with Barry and Amanda again. And then, of course, got to meet Mark and Kim a year and a half ago. With Mark, it feels like it was longer, but I guess it wasn't. But I have four children. My beautiful wife, Linnell, we have four kids. Andy is 17. Breelan is 14. Emma is 11. And Ella is 7 months. Yes, bow your heads and close your eyes. And I do travel full time. Yesterday I was in Arizona singing, and today I am here. And I'm telling you, it is an honor and a privilege to be here this morning. Thank you for having me. And let's sing this one. How deep the Father's love is for each and every one of us. And let's share that love with each other, all right? Listen. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away. As wounds which mark the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
18, verses 31 through 35. And as we read the text, there's such a wonderfully sweet spirit. Thank you for being here. Grateful for Mark and Kim. We celebrate with Dorothy this special weekend. And as we explore this text, our prayer is we would know more of the depth of the Father's love for us. When he was gone, it's important that we understand that he in this passage is not Jesus, but Judas. This occurs after the Last Supper. When he was gone, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself, and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you a little longer. You will look for me, and as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." In one of Dr. King's memorable sermons, he declared, "I've decided to stick with love, for hate is too great a burden to bear. What the world really needs is love, and not just any love, but God's love, and not just God's love, but God's love expressed by God's people." In multiple places, Jesus urged his followers to love one another. It comes as no surprise to us that the Gospels spend a lot of time talking about love. For God so loved the world. Love your neighbor. Love your enemy. Love one another. Love yourself. As I read these texts, both from John's Gospel, the one that I've read and the one that Mark read, I am resoundingly reminded that love is rooted in action and not necessarily affection. Tina Turner had it right when she sang, "Love is not a second-hand emotion." In most of the biblical texts, Old and New Testament, love is an action verb, not a certain feeling. In other words, the call from God, both before Jesus and through us, is to practice love even when we don't feel love. I'm so grateful for Pat's singing. I won't add to Mark's diatribe, but I have many dangerous and risky memories of Pat growing up. Pat's dad and my mother went to high school together. And then I met Pat's dad at the bowling alley when he bowled with my father and his brothers my sophomore year in high school. And then Pat's dad came to my church to lead a revival. Little did I know that he would become my dear friend and beloved minister of music. And by the way, Mark mentioned the awards, and if you Google gospel music, Pat's name is constantly mentioned among the best bass singers. But if you ask Pat, who is the best bass singer, he would never say himself. He would always say his dad, and his dad was one of a kind. But when Pat was growing up, he was more than a typical young man, and Pat Linnell is not here this morning, so she's not going to hear this. But if I recall, we were on several youth retreats when you were growing up, several events at Samford University, several events in Gatlinburg, but I think you were in that group, that trio of young men in Panama City, Florida, who soon after our arrival met three young ladies from the group next door. And by Vespers on the second evening, they had moved from speaking to sort of holding hands. And so one Christian youth group and another. By the way, some of you here met your spouse in youth group or singles ministry or Baptist campus ministry. But they had it bad for each other. And on Thursday night, we were approaching the last service, and the other youth in the group noticed that the three young ladies were about to say goodbye to the three young men. And there was great tension and emotion in the air. And once these three attractive young ladies walked away, and Pat and Scott and Eric came back to sit around the pool, spontaneously, this dynamic youth group, who had all seen the first Top Gun movie, broke into "You've Lost That Love and Fear." And that's what I remember about that. Well, I've never forgotten that song, and I haven't yet seen the new Top Gun movie. But I know a lot of people who've lost that love and feeling. Now, thankfully, the young adults in this youth group all did an extraordinary thing, and that congregation, as Mark knows, proved you don't have to be big to be powerful. They've been influential, they've been minister, they've made a difference in missions in Alabama because they were committed. But you can be married 1 or 2 years, you better be prepared, you're going to lose that loving feeling. And you have to rekindle, rekindle, rekindle. You may have been baptized last year or 50 years ago, but you're going to lose that loving feeling. If love for you is simply an emotion, the emotions will come and go, but the commitment will not. The word here in the Gospel of John is the verb form of agape. Agapate, the present active imperative verb. It means to love without expecting anything in return. And when John recorded Jesus saying you're to love one another, he didn't say love when you feel like it, love when it's convenient, but love expecting nothing in return. And when you love, love with the love of God that you've learned from me. Love is always rooted in action. And on MLK weekend, it's important that the church have a revival of loving in their words and their actions. Love must be learned before it can be lived. I wish that we came into this world with the love of God as part of our default software package. But it doesn't happen. We have to learn it. The love that we have as human beings is quite fickle. We learn to love when we get our way and not to love when we don't get our way. We learn to love selfishly rather than selflessly. Love is not our default human response. The love of God in us must be cultivated. It must be nurtured. It must be reinforced and frequently rekindled. Rick Warren said learning to love unselfishly is never an easy task. It runs counter to our self-concerned nature. And because love must be learned before it can be lived, we must love others because God first loved us. God is the standard. And God in the flesh, Jesus himself demonstrated that standard of God's love. We do not love others so that God will love us. However, when we experience the love of God, we are inspired, we are motivated, we are prompted to love others. That's the reason John 15:9 says, as the Father has loved me, so now I love you. Now remain in my love. The text literally means be fixed, be steadfast, be rooted and grounded in my love. For the love of God, as we learn it through Jesus, is always inclusive and unconditional. John's gospel begins with a story that concludes, for God so loved the world. Now, after this conversation with Nicodemus, we have multiple parables and sermons till we get to today's text, which is called Jesus' final discourse. He's about to leave this world, and over, multiple times, he reminds his disciples of the importance of love. Our growth in Christ is dependent on the way we love. Our future as a congregation is contingent on the way we love. The greatest opportunity we have to make an impact on our family, on our workplace, on our school, and our world is through love. Bonhoeffer reminded us in those painful writings of his, God does not love some ideal person out there, but rather human beings just as we are. Not some ideal world, but God loves the real world. With all of his troubles, with all of his wars, with all of his conflict, God loves the real world. And God's love, regardless of how legalistic a person can become, God's love is without prerequisite or precondition. We do not have to qualify. God loves us out of the wellspring of God's grace. Philip Yancey said it so poignantly. We need to let it soak in that there's nothing we can do to make God love us more, and there's nothing we can do to make God love us less. Our friend Richard Rohr, who's himself fighting a battle with cancer, penned these words that we all need to know, that God's love is great, and God does not love us because we are good. God loves us because God is good. That nothing human beings can ever do will decrease or increase God's eagerness to love. Which leads us to the final point of emphasis in this text. If love is inclusive and unconditional, Jesus, according to John, summarized one of his last sermons by saying, and they will know you're my disciples by the way you love. They will know that Wieuca is following Jesus by the way you love. They will know the authenticity and genuineness of your faith by your love. They will know you're Christians by your love. The Bible says they'll know we're Christians by our love. The Bible never says they'll know Christians by our power. It never says they'll know we're Christians by our popularity. It never says they'll know we're Christians by our purity. It never says they'll know we're Christians by our possessions. And it certainly never says they'll know we're Christians by our politics. But it does say emphatically they will know we're followers of Jesus by our love. And love feeds the hungry. Love welcomes the refugee. Love advocates for justice and equality. Love forgives the perpetrator. Love works and prays for peace. Love conquers evil. Love befriends the lonely. And love encourages us over and again to follow the very one who himself is the author of love. So what we gain from this text is that love is a verb. If it's just a noun, we'll keep it on a shelf. If it's just an adjective, it will come and go. But because love is a verb, it's a part of the fabric of our being. It's our motivation. It's our spiritual sustenance. Love is a verb, a dynamic verb. And when we dare to love others with the love of Christ, there's a kingdom force unleashed within us that empowers us to act with justice, to show mercy, and to walk humbly with God. And that's the gospel truth. Which led Dr. King to conclude one of his sermons about love by saying, love is the only force in the universe capable of transforming an enemy into a friend. Despite all the beauty of the earth and its dynamic potential, there is without question a pervasive darkness in the world in which we live. And Dr. King looked at his congregation and said, darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. And then he added, hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. And when we come to the end of the gospel text, it's compelling and inviting. For the love of God is both inviting and inclusive and encouraging and embracing. For everyone is invited and no one is left out. The love of God embraces us and encourages us. The love of God convicts us and converts us. But the love of God leaves us with a choice to make. We can accept it, or we can reject it. This week, moreover, this very day, would you let the love of God so engulf your life? Would you let God love you in such a way that God would in turn love others through you, especially those the world deems unlovable? Back in those retreat days, there's a little chorus that we learned. It was based on this text, and it says, "They will know we are Christians by our love." And I think those words shape our commitment for this experience of worship. If you're at a juncture in your life where you're ready to receive God's love for the very first time and begin the faith journey of following Him, we want to be your encourager. And after today's service, touch base with one of our ministers and we'd love to have a sit-down conversation. For all of us for whom love has been too much of a feeling, today let us commit to let love be a verb and God to love the world through our hands, our feet, our time, our talent, and our treasure. Let's stand as Rick leads us in singing these words of commitment. They'll know we are Christians by our love.
But he must take it because conscience tells him it is right.
And finally, if you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, you have to keep moving forward. So the last announcement is Lunch Bunch and Sunday Funday are both planning to be off campus the last Sunday of this month. So that's especially for elementary, middle, and high school students. The pre-K students will be staying on campus. But if you are a parent of an elementary, middle, or high school student, Whenever we get ready to take students off campus, it is really helpful if we have an RSVP so that we can arrange for transportation and paying for the different items and tickets that we may need to do in advance. So if you can help us with that, we are definitely looking forward to having a really fun Sunday at the end of this month.
Thanks, Ashley. And if you'll stand now for our closing benediction.
Thank you, Josh and Ashley. It's great to see you here. Great to see former members who've come back for sort of a class reunion. Great to have Mark and Kim and Pat. And Mark and Kim and Pat, if you'd sort of linger around, let folks speak to you, that'd be great. Some of our staff members will be at the doors. Rick's going to be at the doors near the Wieuca Road entrance. Josh and Ashley will be at the entrance. I'll be laying around the front. If there are decisions about membership or about your personal faith, we'd love to speak with you about those. If you're a guest with us and I haven't had the privilege of meeting you, I'd love the opportunity to say hello. Also, if you can move quickly afterward, you'll have time to get your birthday hug to Dorothy, and she's sitting there. Many of you have already delivered cards, and once again, we say happy birthday to Dorothy Pryor. I hope you have a great afternoon. Join me for our benediction and blessing. May we pray together. Send us out, O Lord, into the world in peace. Give us courage. Help us to hold on to what is good and to encourage one another, to assist those who are suffering, and to respect all persons, to love and to serve you with the very best of our gifts. And now may the love of God, the light of Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Go in peace in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen.